Good morning everyone, all the students of class plus 1B beta. As you know, we are doing this chapter, we are not afraid to die, and last few pages are left, only I guess 1.5 pages left. Fine, so we will be completing that. So before I start with this, firstly you can see the board. I guess it's visible to you. I have written in bold letters so that it is quite visible to all of you. I have written bit of facts related to this chapter. Clear? That on which date, what happened, when started they, when did they start their journey and how it continued. It will help you. You can note down also if you have paper and pen with you, kindly arrange. After discussing this, we will be continuing our last 1.5 page. Fine. So we are not afraid to die. The very first point I have written is in July 1976, author and his family set sail from Plymouth, England. So the journey started in July 1976. Fine. Author and his family. Clear? And from Plymouth, England. Then in the, you can say, first part of journey, that was 1,05,000 kilometers. You need to remember the facts better. 1,05,000 kilometers. They covered pleasantly without facing any trouble or minor troubles were there. They were easily just sailing. Fine. So that was the thing. The next is they took two crewmen. After completing their journey, they just took two crewmen along with them. I have written the name Larry and Herb. One was American. One's nationality was American. The other one was from Switzerland. So we call him a Swiss. Fine. So both the, why did he just decided? Because the condition, we can say the, they just were sailing in easy waters, I must say, where there was no difficulty. But now they wanted some professionals with them so that they can go through the rough weathers easily. Fine. So they decided to take two crewmen with them. Then we have on December 25th, they were 3,500 kilometers east of Cape Town. So that was their position on 25th of December. Clear? 1976. Then, not 1976, maybe the next year, because first part was for a year only. Then we have on 2nd January, beta. On 2nd January, waves were mighty. The situation was worst on 2nd January. They did celebrate Christmas on 25th December. They had New Year also, but from 1st Jan onwards, situations were getting worst. Fine. And waves were mighty, gigantic, even they were rising higher than their boat. So they were able to, you know, perceive the situation is not getting better. On 2nd January, waves were mighty. On 3rd January, the water pumping continued. So they had an idea, water was there everywhere on the deck, in the rooms of the boat and all. So they were having electric pumps with them. With the help of those crewmen, they started, you know, pumping the water out from that boat madly. For on January 4th, they had meal. They had their meal after 36 hours of continuous pumping. They were so, you can say, involved into this saving their lives that they could not get time to eat only. And moreover, everything was in chaos over there. They were not able to find their food, their clothing, whatever was there was getting smashed into the water. So they could find beef and some eatables. So Mary, his wife, arranged for everyone. They had their meal on 4th Jan. Then on 5th Jan, situation was quite dangerous. In spite of their so many efforts, everybody was involved. You know, Sue also got a big bump over her head. Her eyes got swollen. She was seriously injured. That girl was seriously injured. Even then, she did not, you know, explain to her parents why. Because she was thinking, my parents are already, you know, worried because of this, and I should not make them more worried. So that was the encouragement from the children's side. And son also, Jonathan, John, he also was aware. He's the one who spoke the words, "Father, we are not afraid to die if we can all be together." When he saw his father was hurt, fine, sister is injurious, and they can get, you know, they can, their boat can sink at any time. Even then, in that situation, he gave a hope to his father that father, if we are together, we are not afraid to die at all. So father got inspiration from the children. He was so filled up with positivity and he started with full zeal again. Clear? Though the situation was very bad. So on 6th Jan at 6 p.m. So this 6 number you need to remember. Fine. At 6 p.m. on 6th of Jan, they reached Isle Amsterdam. As I told you, their boat was not in that proper condition that they could reach their destination. So they were having an idea that nearby there is a pinprick island, a small island in the vast ocean. Two islands were there, but they could find this Isle Amsterdam. And they, you know, after driving, after pumping and after trying to meet his children and wife, Arthur was so tired that he was asleep in one of the rooms. And, you know, when he woke up, he was shocked. His, you know, his kids came and they hugged him and they said, "You are the best father and the best captain," because he was the captain of that ship, you can say. So he was so, you know, shocked. Ki, why my kids are hugging me? Why they are encouraging me? And he was so happy to see that when he was sleeping, they have reached their destination. Fine. So this is the saga of success. The last point you can see, they reached Isle Amsterdam at 6 p.m. on 6th of Jan. Fine. All the points are, I hope it's clear to you. Now we would be reading the 1.5 page which is left. Okay. I would be sharing the screen with you better now of the chapter. You might be having books. You prefer looking at your books only and keep pen and pencils ready in case you need to note down some words. So we have 4 students absent today. Why so? They have started taking it very casually. Those who are absent will be, you know, getting messages from me personally. English is not a casual subject. So it's clear to you, beta, on page number 16, last 2 paragraphs. We have read this, so let's start from this onwards. When I went in to comfort the children, John asked. So when I went in to comfort the children, John asked, "Daddy, are we going to die?" I tried to assure him that we could make it. But Daddy, he went on, "We are not afraid of dying if we can all be together. You and mummies, you and I." So these are the words uttered by Jonathan, his son. So he says, "If mommy, you and I, my sister, all are together, we are not at all afraid to die, father. We are with you." I could find no words with which to respond, but I left the children's cabin determined to fight the sea with everything I had. You know, for the parents, everything, when their children are dying, they can do anything. Even they can put their own lives to stake. So he decided, "My son is giving me hope. So definitely, I'm not going to leave any effort, no stone unturned." He put in double efforts and continued with it. With the undamaged porthole facing the oncoming waves, using an improvised sea anchor of heavy nylon rope and 2 22-liter plastic barrels of paraffin. Paraffin is used to stop the water coming inside the boat. So he was using all the efforts, ropes, and whatever equipments he was having. He was trying his level best. That evening, Mary and I sat together holding hands as the motion of the ship brought more and more water in through the broken planks. We both felt the end was near. See the situation. He was, you know, knowing that they're not going to, you know, escape the situation. So he decided to have a moment with his wife. He sat down with his wife, Mary. He was holding her hands. Maybe he was thinking that this is the last time we're sitting together. Fine. So he was holding hands and he was just knowing, he was knowing that the end is near. That evening, Mary and I sat together, but Wave Walker rode out the storm, and by the morning of January 6th, with the wind easing, I tried to get a reading on the sextant. Back in the chart room, I worked on wind speeds, changes of course, drift and current in an effort to calculate our position. The best I could determine was that we were somewhere 150,000 kilometers of ocean looking for a 65-kilometer wide island. See, you can imagine that 65-kilometer wide island, the width they have given of the island, that's why they have said the pinprick. was so small that they were somewhere in 150,000 kilometers of ocean, and they were looking forward for to find a 65 kilometer wide island. It is very difficult task. While I was thinking, Sue moving painfully joined me. Now his daughters joined in. The left side of her head was now very swollen and her blackened eyes narrowed to slits. She gave me a card she had received. Beautiful gesture made by Sue. She decided to, you know, give hope. Every member of the family is quite positive in this dire situation. She, you know, beautifully made a card for his parents, especially father. She knew that my father is working tirelessly for hours to save their lives. So to give them a, you can say, comfort, to give him positivity and encouragement, she made a beautiful card and gave it to his, to her father. And on the front, she had drawn caricatures of Mary and me. Caricatures, you know? Caricatures are, beta, the cartoon pictures of the original people. You can say you have seen the newspapers. You these days, you see the caricatures of politicians. The funny memes are there with the, their face. Fine, these are called caricatures. So she draws the pictures of father and mother. Then after that, she gave that card to her father. Fine. And what was written over there? Here are some funny people. Did they make you laugh? I laughed a lot as well. So on the front, pictures were there. And with this, these words, she gave it to her father. I laughed a lot as well. And he also started, you know, laughing. So see, the situation is quite serious, but even then they are happy. Inside was a message. Oh, how I love you both. So this card is to say thank you and let's hope for the best. So underline these words uttered by Sue. She was having a big bump on her head, beta. Eyes were swollen. Even she was not able to see properly. Even then, she is making card for the parents. I checked and rechecked my calculations. We had lost our main compass and I was using a spare which had not been corrected for magnetic variation. You know, compass is there to tell the direction. This is not the compass which you use in mathematics. This is the compass which tells us the directions when we are going into the waters or through the waters somewhere. So he saw that he was, his compass was damaged already, but he was having one extra compass which was not correct. But even then he was trying to make some calculations. I made an allowance for this and with another estimate of the influence of the westerly currents which flow through this part of the Indian Ocean. So they were going through this. About 2 p.m. I went on deck and asked Larry to steer a course of 185 degrees. So he was having a rough idea that from which direction to follow, and he gave instructions to Larry, who was driving the wheel. If we were lucky, I told him, with the conviction I did not feel he could expect to see the island at about 5 p.m. So father told Larry that, see Larry, I'm just telling you, go to this direction in 185 degrees. And if we are lucky enough, by God's grace, we will be able to reach Isle Amsterdam by 5 p.m. And if we are not lucky, God knows what will happen to us. Then with a heavy heart, I went below, climbed on my bunk and amazingly dozed off. When I woke up, it was 6 p.m. and growing dark. I knew we must have missed the island. And with the sail we had left, we could not hope to beat back into the westerly winds. When he woke up at 6 p.m., he was so shocked that how could he sleep so long? Why did he sleep so long? Because he was damn tired after so many days of pumping and trying to save lives of everyone and driving the wheel and so many things he did. So he slept, and at 6 p.m. when he woke up, he thought, oh my God, we missed the Isle Amsterdam. Maybe we have just, you know, passed, crossed that thing. And he just forgot, or maybe they lost their directions. And now he thought, we are not going to survive. And at that moment, a tousled head appeared by my bunk. There are bunks, beta, you know, as you see in the trains also, in boats also, they have bunks. So one head emerged out of it. Can I have a hug? Jonathan asked. Sue was right behind him. So John came first to hug his father. And then Sue was standing right behind him. Why am I getting a hug now? I asked. So Arthur asked, why are you hugging me now? Because you're the best daddy in the whole world and the best captain, my son replied. Not today, John, I am afraid. So father was afraid that why my son is trying to, you know, give positivity to me. I have not tried my level best. He was saying, not today, my son. Why? You must be, said Sue in a matter of fact voice. You found the island. So these words are uttered by Sue. Underline. What? I shouted. It's out there in front of us. They chorused. Chorused means spoke together, both the children. As big as a battleship. So she says, just go and see. We have reached the islands to them. I rushed on deck and gazed with relief at the stark outline of Isle Amsterdam. It was only a bleak piece of volcanic rock with little vegetation, the most beautiful island in the world. Why it is the most beautiful island? Now, this island is going to save their lives also. And it is, islands are always beautiful. They're full of vegetation. When the things are, you know, away from human reach, they are beautiful. Humans, they start cutting trees and they just destroy the beauty of the nature. So islands are untouched by human beings and they remain intact as the beauty given by the God. So the natural beauty was there. We anchored offshore for the night and the next morning, all 28 inhabitants of the island cheered as they helped us ashore. You know, I already told you on islands, there is not much, many people live or there, if there is population that is, that can be counted on fingers. Very few people were there. So we anchored offshore. They reached next morning. There were 28 inhabitants on the same island. They were so happy to find them. Fine. And they helped them to reach ashore with land under my feet. After the help of those people, they could reach back. And with land under my feet again, my thoughts were full of Larry and Herbie, cheerful and optimistic under the direst stress. So these two crewmen played very important role. They saved the lives of themselves and as well as of the author's family and of Mary, who stayed at the wheel for all those crucial hours. Even Mary, author's wife, she also helped a lot. And most of all, I thought a seven-year-old girl who did not want us to worry about a head injury. She was severely injured, but she did not complain. Now read the bracketed information, beta. Which subsequently took 6 minor operations to remove a recurring blood clot between skin and skull. That injury was not a minor injury which Sue got on her head. It was a serious injury. She did not utter a word to her parents. When they reached back, she had 6 surgeries because there was a blood clot between head and skull. So 6 times she had to go under surgery to remove that clot, and finally her life was saved. See, and of a 6-year-old boy who was not afraid to die. So after reaching back to his native place, author was thinking of his crewmen, how madly they were helping him, his wife, how she was steering the wheel, his son who was encouraging him that, father, don't worry, even if we die, we are not afraid of it. And the daughter who was injured, everybody was together. You know, united we stand, divided we fall. That's why I told you this is the theme of this chapter. Fine. That if you are together, nobody can shake you, nobody can break you. But if, you know, you might have heard that story in which unity is strength when you were a child, that sticks, when they are alone, you can break those sticks. When all the sticks together put in a bundle, that bundle cannot be broken easily. There is strength in unity, beta. Fine. So they were united and they were able to go through it. They reached their destination. So now I would be discussing the question answers with you, beta. Rather than I discuss, I accept you people to participate in it. Fine. How many of you are ready to participate? Let's see. Firstly, the question answers. See, I was so engrossed in this, I did not change the page even. And you people did not even ask me. You are having the books, I know. So we will be doing the question answers. A few questions I will be discussing, and then I will be asking you also. Okay, better be prepared for your test. Those who have joined later, let me tell you, today you have English test at 5 p.m. 5 minutes before you will be getting it, 4:55 p.m. you will be getting it, and last time to submit is 5:40 p.m. and 40 minutes are given to you. After 5:40, link will be closed, nobody can submit it. But it is very easy test, you will be able to do it even within half an hour. MCQs will be there, you will click on the link the way you are doing other subjects, you will get a form, you will submit it. If it asks you for email ID, you have to submit your email ID also, because sometimes the fake IDs are there, sometimes children are logging in from some other things. So you will be putting your, if it asks you to put your email ID, then you will be logging in by that. If it does not ask, then you can straight away do it. Fine. After doing carefully and submitted, all the questions are compulsory to complete. Only 10 questions will be there out of Portrait of a Lady, and we are not afraid to die. Clear? And you are supposed to read the chapters only, beta. Today you will read the chapters, and then you will appear for the test. Rather than mugging up the question answers, just read the facts, read the chapter, what is there in the story, what happened next, and that. Clear? All the best for your test. So now I would be discussing the question answers with you.